All right, we'll give it another minute or two. So how are you doing today?
Great, how about you?
All right. They had kind of a rough game, didn't they, against Pittsburgh?
Yeah, sadly.
I got to see them last year when my daughter and son-in-law lived in Baltimore. They probably the best game they played. They were playing Houston, and they beat them like
40. Oh, yeah.
They're wiped out. Real wiped out. I don't think you could ask for a better performance on both sides of the ball. But, you know, they're still doing well. Fun team to watch with Lamar at quarterback. They probably need another wide receiver.
Yeah, we need better wide receiver. We'll kind of dig one then.
So, did you all vote where you live?
I'm voting on today.
I'm going to Florida.
You're voting today?
Yeah.
Good for you. And where do you live?
That's Florida. Oh, you're from here.
Huh? Both of you.
Oh.
So you're in Florida?
I live in Mitchell, so I'm going to be out of class.
Okay. And you said, where was it?
Mitchell.
Oh, Mitchell. Yeah, that's not too bad. I got you. You're just going to drive down there before 6 in the afternoon. Mm-hmm. And then where are you from again?
Tampa.
Did you do absentee or? You didn't vote? Oh, no. Vote, exercise the franchise people die for. My gosh. All right, well, we'll go ahead and get started. If anybody else shows up, that's great. Today, we're going to talk about our schedule and some upcoming assignments that we've reviewed before, and then we'll move forward. This week, we're going to talk about persuasion theory. Some of the persuasion theories are not in the textbook, so you will be well served to take notes and ask questions if something isn't clear. A theory is basically a concept that explains a certain behavioral process or cycle that people go through when they try to advocate or encourage someone to do what they want, whether that's changing their attitude, encouraging to act a certain way, or encouraging them to get involved or engaged in a particular group or organization. So we'll start off today with our words of the day. Last week, our words of the day were beguile and acumen. And beguile means to mislead by cheating or tricking. Salesman beguiled the young man into buying a faulty car or a lemon. And then acumen is keenness or shrewdness. Einstein possessed the acumen to unravel the secrets of the universe. So again, you can... take the two that we previewed this week and want to go into the Dropbox and post a definition, you can earn extra credit at one point for definition. You do need the definition, the source it came from, and the date you accessed it. So if it's an online source, you know, it'll be today's date. So our words of the day for this week will be xenophobia and immutable. Xenophobia is a pretty timely word given what's going on in our nation. All right, so our tip of the day is to dress for success in formal speaking situations. Obviously, you don't have to dress formally in every setting or situation. But what you're going to find is if you're going and representing a company that you work for, an organization, you're better off dressing at a high level, looking nice, so that you deflect away any criticism and you appear to be professional. So over the weekend, we competed at the community college in our second online tournament. And the young lady that was our participant, she taped, it's very strange, welcome to COVID, taped her poetry program, and we saved and processed that, and then she did 3 impromptu speeches, and we taped each one of those, and then we processed it to YouTube and put it on the website for the judges to evaluate. So she actually took 5th in poetry. It wasn't a big event, but nonetheless, she got experience. She'd never competed in a tournament before. But the one thing I thought Marie did really, really well, because I talked to her and I showed her videos of other performers from other schools, is she dressed properly for the event. She didn't need to wear, you know, a fancy gown or anything like that. You need to be able to stretch out and physicalize your message. when you're speaking, and when you're doing poetry, you can get really dramatic, so you don't need to wear something that's really tight and constricting. So she wore just a blouse, you know, a very nice blouse that looked good, and, you know, a pair of slacks, and she was fine. And, you know, the camera shot was from about waist up, as it is with me here. So she did a real good job without me having to, you know, give her a lot of tips or a lot of advice as to what she needed to look like, because, again, I showed her what other competitors were wearing. I said, you want to be comfortable, but you want to look professional. Now, the normal person who's debating, our debaters, they usually wear suits. If they're male, they wear suits. If they're female, they usually wear, you know, a blouse or something like that. But the key is, when you walk into a room and you're talking to an audience and nobody knows who you are, the very first thing to look at is, what do you look like? And that may not seem fair in 2020, but that's the way it is. And if you walk in and you look sloppy and you don't look well turned out, and you're wearing clothing that's ill-fitting or doesn't work, they may make negative judgments, not just about you, but about the organization you represent. Okay? So that's our tip of the day. All right, so let's talk a little bit about our schedule. I think we talked about the historic speaker evaluation. There is a two-page, somebody asked me, you know, do we need to do an outline for that? No. You're evaluating an historic speech from AmericanRhetoric.com. We're going to look at an historic speech this morning or this afternoon so you can assess it. It's a two-page form that you use. The first page is rating blocks, and the second page is you answering specific questions. You should type the form, and you should make sure that you write detailed explanations on the first page explaining your ranks and ratings. It's like a five-point range, five being the highest, one being the lowest. Okay? Yes, sir.
What is it due again? Oh, no, my. When is it due?
It's due December 5th.
December 5th.
Well, and actually, for you guys, that's not true. It's due November 30th because you have everything due earlier.
Oh, okay.
So it's due at the end of our semester. So it's coming up. You need to get it and get on with it. So to that end, let's take a look at an historic speech. I tried to get this to work the other day. It was not working. Sound wasn't working today. I think it is working okay. So let me set the context of this very quickly, and then we'll hear it. So in 1968, America was in turmoil. We were engaged in the Vietnam War, which a lot of people at that time, young people, men specifically, were subject to being drafted. And if you were drafted, you had to go into the military and serve your country. And for a lot of young men, particularly in the inner cities, Detroit, Cleveland, Chicago, that meant they were going to Vietnam. And they were probably going to be on the front lines of a war zone. The second issue that was going on at that time was the civil rights movement is still going on. You've got Martin Luther King advocating for equality, economic equality, social equality, the right to vote, all those things in 1968. And you have a series of flashpoints, a lot of rioting going on, a lot of assassinations. Malcolm X had been assassinated several years previous. And so Martin Luther King, on that particular day Robert F. Kennedy was in Indianapolis running, campaigning for the Democratic nomination for president. He was in Indianapolis, and he got word from his staff that King had been assassinated in Memphis, Tennessee at the Lorraine Motel, and he said, stop the car. They were headed to the airport, and he said, does this crowd, there was a huge crowd of people who were having a public event, a political event, I think they were trying to register voters, and he said, do they know that King is dead? Because keep in mind, there's no internet back then, there isn't any of this, and his advisor said, no, but we don't think it's safe, because it was an inner city neighborhood. He said, I don't care, I want to talk to them. So that's what the speech is. It's him standing at a lot, late at night, talking to a crowd of strangers about sharing with them, alerting them that King has died because they don't know it, and then talking about the nature of the laws. And it should go to the media.
Eventually. Could you roll it outside, please? I have some very sad news for all of you, and that is that Martin Luther King was shot and was killed tonight in America. Dedicated his life to love and to justice between fellow human beings. He died in the cause of that effort. this difficult day, this difficult time for the United States, it's perhaps well to ask what kind of a nation we are and what direction we want to move in. For those of you who are black, considering the evidence evidently is that there were white people who were responsible, you can be filled with bitterness and with hatred and a desire for revenge. We can move in that direction as a country, in greater polarization, black people amongst blacks, and white amongst whites, filled with hatred toward one another. Or we can make an effort, as Martin Luther King did, to understand and to comprehend and replace that violence, that stain of bloodshed that is spread across our land, with an effort to understand compassion and love. For those of you who are black and are tempted to be filled with hatred and mistrust of the injustice of such an act against all white people, I would only say that I can also feel in my own heart the same kind of feeling. I had a member of my family killed, but he was killed by a white man. But we have to make an effort in the United States. We have to make an effort to understand, to get beyond or go beyond these rather difficult times. A favorite poem, my favorite poet was Aeschylus. He once wrote, "Even in our sleep, pain which cannot forget falls drop by drop upon the heart, until in our own despair, against our will, comes wisdom through the awful grace of God." What we need in the United States is not division. What we need in the United States is not hatred. What we need in the United States is not violence and lawlessness, but is love and wisdom and compassion toward one another, feeling of justice toward those who still suffer within our country, whether they be white or whether they be black. We can do well in this country. We will have difficult times. We've had difficult times in the past, but we will have difficult times in the future. It is not the end of violence. It is not the end of lawlessness, and it's not the end of disorder. But the vast majority of white people and the vast majority of black people in this country want to live together, want to improve the quality of our life, and want justice for all human beings that abide in our land. I want to dedicate ourselves to what the Greeks wrote so many years ago, to tame the savageness of man and make gentle the life of this world. Let us dedicate ourselves to that and say a prayer for our country and for our people. Thank you very much.
So that's an important speech for several reasons. We've been to Indianapolis for speech and debate tournaments, and I actually stopped the van one time so we could see the plaque that stands in this inner city neighborhood. I think it's like 23rd Street for downtown Indianapolis. And what's so important about this speech is he does this on the spur of the moment. There's no preparation. And the second is that on that night, across America, in response to King's assassination, the cities of Detroit and the cities of Los Angeles and the cities of Chicago and New York, New Jersey go up in flames in the midst of violent rioting. There is no riot in Indianapolis, Indiana that night. The city stays calm. And it's attributed in large part to his act of, you know, trying to be a peacemaker there. Tragically, Robert F. Kennedy was assassinated just 3 months later at the Ambassador Hotel in Los Angeles. He just won the California primary. He was on track to be the Democratic nominee for president. He would have faced Richard Nixon. He probably would have beaten Richard Nixon. But he was assassinated, and as a result, the Democrats had to turn to Hubert Humphrey, who was the sitting vice president at the time, and he lost a narrow contest to Nixon. So that's, you know, what could have been. And, of course, he's referencing he lost a brother. What brother would that have been? No, he's talking about his own brother.
Oh, his own brother.
Robert Kennedy. Who would that be? Yes, John Kennedy. Right. I want to make sure we get the historical context there. Yeah. That would be correct. Well, I mean, indirectly, he was his brother. You're right. But genetically, no.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. So moving on. So the next thing we're going to do is our song of the day. And this is sort of interesting. So this is the last song Glenn Campbell ever performed. Glenn Campbell was a multi-platinum artist for many, many years. He did country music. He did pop. He did rock. And then at about age 72, he was diagnosed with Alzheimer's. So he had to come to an end performing. He couldn't remember the lyrics to his own songs, but this is the last performance he ever gave in a studio before he basically retired. And then about a year later, he died. But Glenn Campbell is a well-known, basically a Grammy-winning legend. Commercial. Skip result. There's a lot of video of his life.
You've been waiting for this, the first iPhone.
Okay, so bars and historic speaker evaluation, that speech that we watched a few minutes ago at Index. The only speech I don't want you to evaluate, as I said, is the Martin Luther King I Have a Dream speech. So yes, you can evaluate that. Somebody says, that means you don't want me to evaluate any Martin Luther King speeches. And the answer is no. You can certainly evaluate Riverside Church, you know, Mountaintop. You can certainly evaluate that. Just don't do I Have a Dream, because like I said, I've had probably 50 of those. I think I probably read my best one somewhere along the way. So that's on here. Okay, so the next issue is the I Believe speech. And so what we want to do there is just take you through and talk a little bit about the guidelines. I know we talked about this before, but I had some people that were running under time last speech, so I want to make sure we don't go over time this time. So the speech itself is 3 to 5 minutes in length. This is where you share an opinion on a controversial issue, okay? And you present three arguments, not two, not four, not five, three supporting arguments that back up your thesis. Okay, so if you want to argue that there should be free college tuition in America, that's your thesis. You need three arguments to support that thesis, okay? You don't need to cite evidence in it, but you can. You need to turn in an outline that follows the format, the same format we overviewed before. And then you need your two practice tapes, okay? So you present three supporting arguments to validate your thesis. When you actually preview your topic, you should list them in Roman numeral order. Like, my topic will be about da-da-da, the reason I'm picking this topic is this, the audience will benefit, then boom, argument one, argument two, argument three, below it. That's how you format when you preview your topic to make sure it gets approved. That's the format you want to follow. So supplemental items, as I said, the outline, two practice sessions. Important to mention, when you do your final taping of the speech, and I think I've said this before, but it bears repeating, make sure you're standing up, okay? When you do the practice sessions, if you're sitting down, that's not a big deal, okay? And it was really actually kind of interesting this weekend. So I'm judging an after-dinner speaking round, which is a humorous speech. And I had to even email with the tournament organizers in Ohio because I said, okay, I had six speakers. It was the final round. And I said I had one sitting down the whole time. Do I need to mark her down? And they said, well, it's up to you, but generally they should be standing. I said, well, I know that, but I just want to make sure. Because I didn't want to get caught with a student who's like disabled and maybe they couldn't get up. So I went ahead and knocked her down like three places. So instead of getting like third, she got like fifth. Well, later, she made finals of another event. She's a student from a nearby school. She had no trouble standing during the finals of Program Doral and Turf. So it's like, okay, A, we're not disabled, and B, we know the rules. So I think she just had an old videotape, and she's like, ah, just take this videotape. And she was sitting the whole time. So when you speak that final edition, the one you're going to be graded on, make sure you're standing, okay? Make sure your camera shot is from the waist up. Pull that camera back so we can see you. We can see your gestures, all that kind of thing, okay? The other item, and this is just stylistic, but it's important to mention, do not use sheets of paper. You should be using note cards that are moderate size, not like the Frisbees that the kids on the Lucas videos use, you know, these huge honking things. They should be smaller. And if you can, flip them so that they are vertical, okay? So they're this way. Instead of doing this, we're doing this, okay? All right, so any questions about this speech? It's due November 15th, which is a Sunday at 11 p.m. Central Standard Time. Some people have already previewed what their topic's going to be, and that's fine. If you haven't done that, I'd recommend you get that done this week and begin the preparations. Questions about that assignment?
You said vertical, right?
Yeah. This is horizontal. Uh-huh. Imagine the sun rising up. This is vertical.
Okay.
As you put your structure this way on the card. And that way your hands are free to gesture. Whereas if you do this, you look like a rope steer, right? It inhibits, potentially inhibits your ability to gesture. And don't use whole sheets of paper. We've still got a few people, not just in this class, but in other classes, that are standing up there with sheets of paper.
What if you like fold it?
That doesn't make it any less obtrusive.
Right.
I would suggest that you reduce it to not. If you want to use a spoken outline, a reduced outline, there's a sample of that on the website. Then create a little podium for yourself and get it out of your hands. Put it on the desk in front of you. You can do that. But it really looks awkward when you're standing there holding sheets of paper, and the odds of you being able to move and gesture nearly as freely are greatly reduced. All right, any other questions about this assignment? Amber, you got any questions about the assignment? All right, so here's your question of the day. Today we have an election. We have two people running, well, we have more than that, but the two major party candidates for president, of course, are Donald Trump for the Republicans and Joe Biden for the Democrats. You get to play political prognosticator. Who do you think will win the election and why? So I'll start with Thomas.
Honestly,
There's going to be a winner at some point.
There's going to be a winner.
Whether we like it or not, yeah. It is possible to have a statistical tie, and if that happens, it'll go to the Supreme Court, which would be a terrible mess. As bad as things are right now with the coronavirus and all the other stuff going on, the last thing we need is judicial action to decide the presidency. We had that in 2000 when the hanging chad ballots in Florida were not counted, and Gore v. Bush, and Gore conceded. Yeah, that was terrible. Because Gore, like Clinton, had won the popular vote, so it caused a lot of consternation and anger that the wrong person had been elected president. But, you know, in terms of the Electoral College, which is what we base it on, who has 270 Electoral College votes or more, Bush won. But the reason he won, the argument was because key ballots and key precincts down in Florida weren't counted. The Supreme Court said you don't need to count them. There were ballots that were flawed or not necessarily properly put in. So anyway, what's your answer? Biden or Trump? And why?
Trump. Well, like up here, okay? Like, I don't know, I've been seeing like stuff on like Instagram and stuff, but the people that are like already voting and stuff, and like the countries like red or blue, and, like most of it's red.
Okay.
And I see a lot of stuff around me.
Well, you're in a red state.
Yeah, you're in a red state.
Okay. Amber, what do you think? Get to play political pundit for 2 minutes.
I know like they count like the in person of the first, so I think Trump will win like tonight, but then like on the ballot vote is not in person. But I know like he's gonna be like California and I always want to be like all the buildings will work great. But some stuff I've been reading, Biden might be in Texas. And if I was like Pennsylvania, I don't know about Florida.
Florida is a state that breaks Democrats' hearts. I'm not gonna count on Florida falling into the Democratic column. If Texas does, that would be a huge surprise. It's possible. The vote in Texas is already well above what it was in 2016, just the number of voters. And a lot of the people that have voted are people your age. In fact, nationally, that's been the biggest demographic that's overperformed by 400% is people your age, which is heartening. You know. Yeah, well, he probably will because he'll win the western states like California and Oregon by a wide margin. But you've still got to have Michigan, Wisconsin, Minnesota, if you can get Pennsylvania. The key flashpoints, if you're paying any attention in the next tonight or tomorrow, will be who wins Pennsylvania, mm-hmm. who wins Florida, who wins Texas. Those are three huge states. If those two of the three or all three go to one of them, mm-hmm. they're probably going to be president.
I think Biden, because they voted blue last time, not for president, but for
Texas has had some close calls, but they have been reliably red for decades.
Yeah.
So if they turn tonight, that'll be a huge change. But it's been predicted to change for years because they have a huge growing Hispanic population. They've got a lot of people who've moved into the state from other areas. They're not all native Texans. Yeah, so we'll see. Okay, very good.
What do you believe that was?
You know, I know who I hope wins, but I honestly, one of the issues you have is like today, 1 million robocalls went out from somewhere, and I don't know which side did it. It's telling people to stay safe and stay home. You know what a terrible message that is to somebody who's like past the age of 65? They're like, oh, I better not go out. It's not safe. I better not go vote. Well, I mean, somebody, you know, what they've done is then they mass media is trying to communicate, ignore those, that's a scam, you know, that's, there are no basis for that. You're welcome to come and vote, people are social distancing, people are wearing masks, we're cleaning the polling places, you know, that kind of thing. I was out this morning at 4 a.m. We have 6 polling places in Davis County that I'm running for office to make sure we had signs near the turn-in spots for all of these precincts. And I thought I was very heartened, not necessarily for my own prospects, but at least in terms of people participating in the process, there were lines at 6 a.m. When they opened at 6, I was at 2 of the polling places, and there was a line. So I thought that was very good. It looked like they were very busy. They looked like they were going to be very steady. And thank goodness there were only 6 polling places, because when I ran for state senate 2 years ago, there were probably 30. And you just can't get to all 30 and stick a sign in the ground or any kind of messaging close. You can do 100 feet, and that's the other thing. You are allowed to do that within 100 feet or further beyond the polling. And 100 feet's nothing. So as long as you're not, you know, right there standing at the bridge of the line, you're going to be fine. Now, I don't think they'd be very happy if I were standing there handing out ink pens and sanitizer while they're standing in line. I'd probably get in trouble for that. But as far as the actual voting, people have parked vehicles in parking lots of some of the precincts. In our case, we put signs up based on the traffic flow into the different facilities so that people would see our name before they went to vote.
That's your sign that you're around town?
I hope so. They were when I got up this morning, yeah. Well, there's 2 Glens running. There's Jim and myself. But I think, I think I've got a lot more signage than Jim does. Jim's running for state rep.
Are y'all related?
Oh, no. Jim, well, brothers from another mother. Jim is my colleague at the community college. He teaches business. He's been a state rep for 10 years. He's the first African American ever voted to the state house in Davis County. And the last election, when he got... He was out of office for 2 years. He lost to the Republican he's running against now. He won by 1 vote. He won by 1 vote. And when they re-canvassed, he won by 5. Yeah, he's had a very interesting political career. But they're out to get him. The Republicans want to get him bad. They want to get rid of him. So, all right, so let's talk about what's left this semester, because you guys are done by Thanksgiving. And let's kind of go through the list of what's left, and then we'll get into persuasion theory. The I Believe speech. The research persuasive speech, which is they're both persuasive speeches. Self-evaluation paper, where you're going to pick 4 speeches and write about the strengths and weaknesses of each. And again, that's due right at the end of the semester. Historic speech analysis, you just use a form, a 2-page form that you should type in and make sure you have lots of detail. You don't need to worry about that. That's in another class. You need to do your top 5 speakers for the macro informative, in your case, the non-process speech and the I Believe. When you get to the research persuasive speech, it turns into the top 3 speakers. So I'll catch you a little break because we're near the end of the semester. Instead of doing 5, you do 3. Topic previews, of course, these are the discussion boards where you tell me what your topics are going to be for each of these. The final exam and Lucas chapter activities are not mandatory for you guys. They're extra credit. We will have another quiz coming up. I'll open that up here pretty quickly over the weekend. So quiz 3 will be up soon, and you want to make sure you take it. All right, so that's what we have left this semester. We're rapidly drawn to the post. So let's talk about persuasion. We talked about chapter 16 the other day. We talked about the nature of the type of topics you deal with for persuasive speeches, like fact, value, and policy. We talked about the different outline formats you use, like problem solution, problem cause solution. So now let's talk about some of these theories. And these are not all in the textbook, so I'd encourage you to take notes or make sure that you record or take a look at the video. So groupthink. Groupthink is present quite often in large organizations, like the U.S. military is a great example. You ever meet somebody who's a Marine? Don't they seem a little bit brainwashed, not to put the Marines down? Yeah, that's because they're acculturated to a certain set of values and standards. And so as a result, if you're a Marine, there are certain things you do and certain things you don't do. For instance, if you're in the midst of battle and one of your party is wounded, you don't leave them on the battlefield. You find a way to retrieve their body or save them, get them out of the line of fire if you can, and get them medical treatment. That's the military code. We don't leave a man behind. We don't leave a woman behind. So that's an example of groupthink. Now, the problem is that in reality, when the bullets start flying and the shells start dropping, that's a wonderful philosophy, but sometimes you can't do it. Sometimes you have to come back. The other element of groupthink is in cults, religious cults, like Jonestown, where people were encouraged to, that Jim Jones was their leader, and he basically encouraged them to do three things that were very strange. One, he said, I want you to work, and every dollar you make, you give to the church. You give it to me. And in return, I'll take care of medical care, I'll provide you with a place to live, and I'll make sure you're fed. And for many years, that's what he did. A lot of the people that joined his church in San Francisco back in the 70s and 80s were drug addicts, alcoholics, people that came from really rough life experiences. And they were, in their view, saved by Reverend Jones and his ministry. But then it takes a dark turn. He decides to create this sort of alternative universe in Guyana in South America. So they create this village called Jonestown. And he encourages people to move down there. And by the time, they start chopping down the jungle and they begin to build houses and they try to create a little bit of a factory there to create revenue. And Jones begins to change. He gets very, very violent with people. He begins to get very dictatorial as to what they can and cannot do. And some people decide they want to leave. They want to go back to the United States. He won't let them. So a congressman by the name of Leo Ryan from California flew down to inspect what had happened. Well, a debacle happened. It's one of the worst episodes of the mass killing we've ever had in American history. So Jones senses that he's going to be in a lot of trouble. And so when this congressman and his staff try to leave, they intercede at the airport and kill him and several of members of his staff. They then have, and this is the group think part, basically persuade 850 out of 900 people to drink Kool-Aid laced with cyanide. Now, that's the ultimate group think. We all think this is okay. Now, in some cases, they were coerced. There were people with guns who said, if you don't do it, I'll just shoot you. And there were others who took their children from them, their young children, and poisoned them first, so they had no reason to live. So that's an example of groupthink, where everybody decides, well, within this culture, what we're doing is normal, what we're doing is right. Well, in Jonestown, you know, when you pull back and look at the examination, a lot of things he was doing were horrible. They were wrong. They certainly weren't reflective of Christian doctrine, Christian theology, and he himself kind of veered off into drug addiction. So it was a real mess, and 900 people died. It was an absolute mess. They all died of mass poisoning. So if you hear the phrase in our culture, you drank the Kool-Aid, that's where that comes from. That you believe without thinking for yourself that you were going to follow somebody's orders, or you're going to follow some particular, group's dictums or demands. And so that's when you hear that phrase, you drank the Kool-Aid, that's what that means. All right, so different types of persuasion. And you've probably been exposed to these. Foot in the door is where a person may call you. They may physically come to your door. They may mail you something. And they will ask, they will make a small request. They'll say, hey, I'm calling from the American Association for the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals. Would you sign our petition to stop the abuse and mistreatment of animals? Now, are you, Amber, would you be willing to do that? Would you be willing to sign a petition to stop cruelty to animals? Sure. Seems easy enough, and it's a small request, right? But then after they get you to sign the petition digitally, fine, I'll digitally add your name to the, as I'm calling you on the phone, I'll add your name to the, we're also trying to fund a new shelter. Would you consider donating, say, $10 just to help us fund this shelter? And you're a real big animal lover, right, Thomas? And so Thomas says, well, yeah, $10. Sure, I can do that. And then it escalates. Well, now we're having a meeting in about 3 weeks. It'll be a digital Zoom meeting. And we want young people like you to be our activism team to help prevent cruelty to animals. Would you be willing to join that? And so it escalates. We get from one small request, it escalates. So once they get their foot in the door, they get your initial agreement to a very small, manageable request. It goes up from there. Now, door in the face persuasion is the opposite. It's where they make an outlandish, and they know you're going to, 90% chance you're going to say no. You're going to say, no, I won't do this. So, Thomas, Kentucky Wesleyan College calls you up after you've graduated. They say, good evening, Thomas. How are you? Go ahead. Great. Well, I'm calling on behalf of the Panther Pride fundraising team here at KWC in Owensboro, Kentucky. I see you graduated in 2023. with a degree in communications. And I know you're proud of your Panther heritage. And we are asking people to help donate, you know, essential funds to help students just like you make it through school without debt. Would you consider donating? Our average donation is $1,000. Would that? Can we count on you for that tonight, Thomas?
I would have to think about it.
Ooh, you'd have to think about it. Oh, we've got a live one on the phone here. Yeah. Most people, 90%, well, would probably say what?
No.
I can't afford that. Are you crazy? I've still got student loans to pay. I'm just trying to get my feet on the ground, you know, start my life. So the answer probably be no. I say, well, how about $500? And they'll keep going down until they get to a number that you will accept. Like, well, how about $25? Any amount will help. And you, $25. So that's storing the face. They expect you to say no to the absurdly large request, and they keep moving it, ratcheting it down until they get to a point where they find a comfort zone that you agree to. And maybe you may say no. I mean, you may say no. You may say, no, I'm just not going to do that. And that's the danger of using door-in-the-face persuasion, is some people are going to go, I'm not giving you $1,000. I paid tuition there. I paid my bills. I'm not adding debt to, you know, I'm not going to pay them any more money. I got my education. It was fine. I'm cool with it, but we're moving on, right? So door-in-the-face is an absurdly large request followed by a more rational, reasonable request. All right, lowballing. This is where you pick up the paper, or you go online, like Black Friday, and there's a really good deal on whatever you want, right? Let's say it's a big screen TV. A big screen TV for $87 at, let's throw it out, Best Buy, Walmart, Target, pick your favorite store. Does that sound like a good deal? $87 for a big screen, 35-inch TV? That you mount on the wall? Yeah! Heck yeah! So good that before COVID, you'd do what? Unlike Black Friday, you'd go stand in the cold at 3 in the morning for the doors to open at 6 to get that deal. And what would happen? Well, the odds are, if you weren't the first one in line, by the time you got in, they would do what? Oh, golly gosh, I'm really sorry. We only had 50 of that item, and we're out. And you're like, well, but I wanted the $87 big screen 35-inch TV. Well, sir, we've got a really nice 30-inch here for $110. But you stood there in the line in the cold for 3 hours. What do you think you're going to do? You're going to buy the 30-inch for $110 because that's still a pretty good deal, even though it's a little less TV, right? Or if you're smart, what you'll do is you'll say, well, wait a minute. You advertised this. It doesn't say there's a limit on quantity. Can I get a rain check? Remember that phrase, rain check. I do that all the time. You tell me I'm out of something at the grocery store, or I'm out of something that's a special like that, I'll say, I need a rain check. Unless it said, first 50, limit of 50, then they're right. Once you get to 50 and we're done, you're done. But the other thing that happens with lowball quite often is that you show up and they don't have the product at all. Hey, our truck didn't come in. Yeah, I know that featured item is the reason you came, you know, but here, we've got these other options. And they try to sell you maybe even something for the same price, but instead of being a 35-inch and being a particular brand you really like, it's like some second-tier brand that you've never heard of. And it's not as big a TV, as an example. All right? So lowballing is where you provide an absurdly great deal, and then when you arrive, the great deal doesn't exist. Great deal has some limitation, a restriction, or a limited number. And as a result, you basically don't get what you want. All right, social judgment theory. We'll actually take a look at here. This will be the last one we talk about today. We'll talk about social judgment theory in the sense of latitudes of attitude. So imagine a continuum, like a chart. And on that, you have latitudes. Imagine your attitude. Let's say, let me think of an example. Something you like. All right, let's say you're a Mac fan. You really like Apple computers. You like Macs. You don't like PCs. And so somebody says, what would it take for me to get you to buy a PC? And your attitude, you have acceptance, attitude of basically rejection, And then you have an attitude of basically non-commitment. So you're really high on the latitude of acceptance. If it's anything Mac, a Mac product, my daughter's that way. But if it's anything related to a traditional PC, no, I won't do it. I won't buy it. I want nothing to do with it. So I remember telling my daughter a few years ago, because she was having trouble trying to do her schoolwork with her Mac. I said, well, how about if I bought you a PC, and then when you have your schoolwork and you get software that doesn't work well, work and play well with the Mac, you can just go to your PC. She says, no, I won't do it. It's bad for security. They steal your passwords. You're more likely to get a virus. I mean, she has all these arguments. So her latitude of rejection is really high. I'm on a scale of 1 to 10. She's at like a 9 or 10 of absolutely not. I will not lower my standards and move from a Mac to a traditional personal computer. I will not do it. All right? And so as a consequence of that, you get into a situation where if I'm going to persuade you to change your mind and move you from a high latitude of rejection for that product, I've got to give you, well, now that used to be true. But now the security systems on PCs are so much better. They're so much more adaptable to software, and you won't have these problems where you can't get your work done because your Mac isn't adaptable to certain types of software like Blackboard or Brightspace. Well, yeah, you're right. So now we got to move in from a 9, maybe a 7 or a 6. And I, by the way, I'll pay half the cost. Dad will pay half the cost. Oh, okay. So now we're at a 5. Now we're at almost a period of not commitment. Shit. Well, if you're going to pay half the cost, I might consider it. So all of a sudden we've moved her from never ever, I will never do it, to, well, maybe. But the problem is that attitudes are like a rubber band. They stretch and they can contract. And so let's say a week later, I say, all right, we're going to Best Buy. We're going to go buy your PC. And she goes, nope. I said, what do you mean, nope? I thought you said you'd be okay with it, especially if I paid half the price. I read an article that the brand you want me to buy is really vulnerable to viruses. And it really doesn't work any better with some of the learning software like Brightspace and Blackboard. So I'm not going to do that. So now she's, what has she done? I got her down to a 5. She's kind of in the middle. She's okay. She could do it or not. And now she's back to a 7 or an 8 on that continuum. She's being highly resistant again. And you know, that's fine. But the issue is, what do you do? Let's deal with something really important. What do you do with something like this? Look at me. Telling people to wear masks. Look at the crap we've gone through getting people to wear masks. I won't do it! It's a violation of my liberties as an American. Never mind that you're going to kill grandma when you go into the nursing home without a mask, right? Or you're going to give it to somebody. The other is, when we have a vaccine, if and when we ever have a vaccine, it's already been calculated, 50% of Americans will say they refuse to get the vaccine, which is what everybody is looking at as the Godhead moment when we can take the masks off and live our lives again. So I'm asking you a question. How would you persuade, think about the continuum, latitudes of acceptance, non-commitment, and rejection. How do you take somebody who says, you'll make me get that vaccine over my cold, dead body? How do you persuade somebody? What are some reasons you'd give them to say, you need to go get the vaccine? It's a matter of civic responsibility. It's a matter of maintaining health. So what would you say to that person, say your friend, is balking at getting, you know, they're resisting the idea of going and getting the vaccine. What would you say to them? I want to hear from both of you. So Amber, what would you say? Right. Well, they won't get a flu shot.
Yeah.
My son is a first responder, and he really doesn't like shots, period. And he doesn't really want to get a flu shot. But fortunately, he's married to a PA. And she, one year, she said, he came home. It was really funny. He came home, and he told her he wasn't getting a flu shot. So she said, hey, I need some help getting a pan from this lower shelf. And when he went to go down to get the pot out of the lower shelf, first year of marriage, she jabbed him with it. She gave him the shot in the rear end. She pulled his pants down. They're married. And he said, what was that? He goes, yeah, you're all set. You got your flu shot. Now, was that so bad? He was mad. But he got a flu shot. But thereafter, he gets it every year, because A, it doesn't cost anything, you know, for him. And B, he needs to get it. It's a work requirement. He cannot be a firefighter and not be vaccinated. Because you're dealing with, when you work with the public, whether you're a police officer, firefighter, EMT, you never know who's got what, okay? And somebody having the flu. All right, so Thomas, somebody tells you, I'm not going to get the vaccine when it comes out for the coronavirus. What are a couple of arguments you would make to say, hey, you got to do this for the good of everybody? What are a couple of arguments you generate?
Well, obviously the mask, if they don't want to wear it, then, like, get the vaccine. But, like,
you want your liberty back? Get the shot.
Yeah. Right. And also, like, if there's, like, other options other than the shot, I would tell them about it. Cause, like, I know some people, like, I'm pregnant as well. Like, so I'll tell them, like, different options they could do instead of getting the shot.
Sure. And they have a non-hypodermic needle version of the flu vaccine. You can inhale it. I think they have it. Yeah, nasal version. You know, it's not necessarily pleasant either, but it's not a shot. I think the other issue, for some people it may be cost, but, you know, they're talking about trying to make it so no one has to pay because it's so essential to the health of the nation. But I think another issue there would be, do you want your life back? Do you want the ability to no longer have to sit there and pull out a tape measure and measure 6 feet between you and everybody else that you want to have reasonable interaction with? Do you want to be able to go to public events again? You know, we like to have a situation where we can fill Steel Stadium and watching a football game or a soccer game, and I don't have to worry about how far I am from you. And I can go to that mass event because it's not a super spreader event. Even if I'm standing next to you, the odds, if I've gotten the vaccine and you've gotten the vaccine, of us contracting it or getting the virus are greatly reduced. They're not absolute, but they're greatly reduced. Because that's the thing with the flu shot. Can you get the flu shot and get the flu? Absolutely, because the flu shot is a predictive element where they kind of, like Las Vegas, they roll the dice and try to predict which flu strain will be the predominant one. Sometimes they screw up. But the doctor's argument to you will be, even if you get the flu and we didn't match up the strain of the shot we gave you with the version you got, your symptoms should be less. You should be less likely to wind up in the hospital. You should less likely to wind up being debilitated, all those things. All right, so when we talk about social judgment theory, what we're talking about is the notion of people trying to change people's minds. And what we discover, just in general about persuasion, is it's hard. It's hard. I mean, think about smoking. I mean, all these studies, thousands of studies have come out that say if you smoke, you increase your risk of lung cancer. If you smoke, you increase your chance of emphysema. If you smoke, you have the potential to damage other people's health if you're in a congested public setting. So if you're a smoker, like my mother was, okay, before the passive smoke studies came in, she would literally fill an ashtray in her mobile home with cigarettes. You'd come home and there'd be 30 cigarettes in the ashtray. She died of lung cancer. She had a stroke. But the issue was she'd smoke in the house. Now, when the passive smoking studies came out, she began to smoke outside in our screen porch. But for years, she smoked in the house, which meant, thanks, Mom, for sure, you know. So that's one of the issues you get into is if you're smoking and you're in an enclosed space, a car, a home, you know, you're risking other people's health as well, including your children. So I think even people that I know who smoke, I think a lot of them are very conscious of trying not to smoke in enclosed spaces with their children or with people who are sensitive, you know, have lung conditions, things like that, elderly people, for instance. But you've still got people that are addicted to cigarettes. They're addicted to cigarettes, and you can't get them to stop. They just won't stop smoking. And that tells you how hard persuasion is. It tells you how hard persuasion is. Drug people who are addicted to drugs, they could go to rehab 5, 6, 7 times, and it won't take. Because the adrenaline rush they get from using the drugs is so special and so unique and so important to them in their mind that they can't get off the drugs. And that's it's really hard to persuade people often to do things that are in their own self-interest. So that's why persuasion as an area of study is so fascinating. Because when you do have situations where you successfully persuade and change people's behavior to be more pro-social, imagine if we had 80 to 90% of Americans wearing a mask and only 10%. Where would we be public health-wise? Maybe better off. Maybe not. but I'm guessing we'd be a little better off. The other would be when we get the vaccine. If you could get 80 to 90% of Americans to get the vaccine, who can handle taking a vaccine, be amazing. Absolutely amazing. And we've seen historically where that happens. Polio, all these diseases that have been virtually eradicated because we have herd immunity produced by the vaccine. Okay? But it's here. People have to be persuaded. You're right. You're absolutely right, Thomas. A lot of people don't like needles. You're right. I don't blame them, you know. But I'd rather have a needle prick for a minute and then never again have to wear a mask and I don't have to worry about social distancing. And if I get coronavirus, it's probably going to be potentially less threatening to my life and quality of life than it would be if I don't. All those things. All right, so we'll pick this back up on Thursday. You won't be here, but that's fine. But we'll pick this back up for you guys next Tuesday. You should be working on your speech, your macroinformative speech topic. You should begin getting that prepared because the time is nigh with that. And then once we're done with that, we're going right to the research persuasive speech because we want to have all the work done except for the final exam. And then watch for quiz 3 to pop up here on Brightspace pretty quickly. Okay? Thank you all very much for being here. Have a good day.
Yep, and good luck with voting, Amber. Hopefully.